Callie with Agaviation Adventures, and today we're talking all things sugar beet harvest. I have Will with me here. He's a farmer here in this area. We're in Northwest Minnesota, and sugar beets are a common crop up here. And we thought it'd be fun to talk a bit about harvest and a little bit about the crop itself. So we're gonna talk about sugar beets a little bit in general, anything that Will wants to add, and then we're gonna walk through harvest and talk about why it's a little bit different than your typical wheat harvest or bean harvest. And we're gonna talk about some really rad equipment that I was lucky enough to ride in. So sugar beets are not grown everywhere throughout the country, and we're really glad, Tyson and I are, as far as spraying goes, because it's one more crop that we have the opportunity to spray up here. Why are sugar beets grown in this area and maybe some more areas throughout the country versus being everywhere throughout the country?
So sugar beets pose a storage problem. They're a perishable crop. So once we harvest them, they start respirating and losing sugar to repair themselves. So being we're in a colder climate, we typically harvest October timeframe, and then we can start freezing those beets for storage and process them all winter. So you typically see them in northern climates, your Idaho, Montana, Michigan area. There are some grown in California that are harvested as needed. So they harvest those year round pretty much, and only harvest what they can process in that time frame.
And you're talking a little bit about harvesting. So here in Northwest Minnesota, harvest starts on October 1st, but you have the opportunity to have kind of a what you call pre-pile, mm-hmm. pre-harvest, which is what we got to be a part of the other day, was pre-pile. So you start with pre-pile, you get a certain amount that you can harvest, and then you have a break, maybe you're harvesting some other crops, and then October 1st it hits and it's a busy time, and that's busy because you can only have so much time to get the crop out of the field and to the plant.
Yeah, so right now we just did pre-pile, which typically starts about August 15th timeframe. We harvest a certain amount of tons based on the number of acres we grow, so each grower has a different number of tons they harvest. And that carries through all the way up to October 1st, with different people going at different times. Then October 1st, we wanna control the piles of beets as much as we can. So the best way to control them is to harvest them, pile them as quick as possible, get them into storage, and then let the factories take over from there. So harvest runs 24 hours a day once we start, barring any heat shutdowns or weather, be it snow or rain,
right,
that shut us down, or freezing conditions.
All right, so speaking of harvest, there's kind of some specialty equipment that goes along with sugar beet harvest. Behind me, we have the lifter, and this is what goes through and lifts the sugar beet out of the ground. But I guess before we talk about the lifter, we should talk about the rotabeater. And it should be mentioned that beets are planted in rows, and you're mentioning that this is a bit different than, say, potatoes. And can you elaborate on that at all?
Yeah, so we grow beets. We plant them with what would be considered typically like a corn planter. We use different plates, obviously. And we plant them in rows 22 inches apart. And so that allows us to just harvest the beet with the lifter versus potatoes, where we're digging, you know, a big wide swath of ground.
Okay.
So a little less dirt involved in that process. But the rotabeater, what that does is we go along with that, and there's spinning flails, and we remove the tops of the beets with that. So get rid of all the green material and take off the very top portion of the beet. And that's typically a portion of the beet that's a corky material and low in sugar, high in impurities, and would lead to impurities in the refining process.
Okay.
And from there, we go along with the lifter, and the wheels pinch the beets, pluck them out of the ground, toss them around, clean them, and load them into trucks. So it's a continuous process. We have a small tank on the lifter for switching trucks, things like that, but basically we're dumping into a truck the entire time, as opposed to your combine that fills up the hopper, dumps into a cart.
And if you're filling a combine, you don't necessarily have to have a truck there at all times, whereas when you're doing beets, you have a truck there all the time by your side.
Yep.
And then when that truck leaves, another one comes right in immediately and you start filling that truck.
Yep. So we fill the trucks, they head to the plant, dump, weigh. After the truck leaves the plant, they come back with what we refer to as tear, which is some broken beet tails, dirt, things like that, because they get cleaned at the plant. And we return the tear to the field, dump that in the field, and then they come under the lifter to get reloaded and sent back to the plant in a continuous process.
Yep. Now, one thing that's always been crazy to me is just how big a sugar beet is. And if you're not around them, you really don't know the size, and they're heavy too. That's why that was a little bit of a hard toss. But this is, would you say this is an average size sugar beet? Or
For this year, they vary depending on stand. You know, this year we fought stands because of drought conditions, so we're seeing bigger beets. But yeah, pretty close to average size.
Now, I'm a visual learner, so I'm gonna lay this out for you. Picture a football field, which is 1.3 acres. So a little bit less than a football field, we have an acre. And you guys are getting about 10,000 pounds of sugar per acre out of the sugar beet crop. That's pretty incredible. That is a lot of chocolate chip cookies. And what are some more statistics of this area specifically that sugar beets are grown in?
So in the Red River Valley, we're known for sugar beets. We grow with our co-op around 400,000 acres of sugar beets annually. We try and shoot for about 11 million tons of sugar beets harvested
a year.
That's insane. That sugar is refined into white sugar, brown sugar, and molasses. And we ship all over the country for use in anything from cookies to industrial baking applications. We also have byproducts of the sugar beet process. We have lime that gets reused on our fields as fertilizer and disease prevention products. And we also have beet pulp, which can go to make anything from ethanol to livestock feed. So our products are pretty versatile.
So at the end of the day, there's really minimal waste that comes out of the sugar beet crop in itself. And with farming, something that's always incredible is that maybe one person thinks that sugar comes from a sugar beet, but there are lots of other uses, as you mentioned. So cool.
Yeah, we're really pushing to lead the sustainability effort in everything we do. We realize the importance of that, and we're trying to do a better job every day.
Hope you guys enjoyed learning a little bit about sugar beets and how they're harvested with us. Thanks to Will for taking the time to do this with us and inviting us out to the field. It's been super fun. Personally, one of my favorite crops because I have quite the sweet tooth. Now, I wanted to ask Will a question. I'm gonna kind of put him on the spot here, but what is one thing, if you could tell the average consumer as a farmer, what's one thing that you would tell them?
Yeah, there's a common misconception in ag these days that most farms, even if they're a corporation, that they're some corporate farm and not a family farm, when in fact most farms are family farms. Like myself, it's me. I took the farm over from my uncle. My dad helps out, have a hired man, and during harvest we hire a few other people. But other than that, it's all family. You know, farming is our livelihood. We do it because we love it. It's a lot of work at times. We realize that, you know, the land is our income. So despite some of the misconceptions out there, we are putting our best foot forward to take care of what we have and provide a future for future generations to keep doing this.
Yeah. You also forgot to mention that farming can be stressful at times, which I feel like, I don't know, just with how you're at the mercy of pretty much nature for your crop, and this year with the drought, there's a lot of stress involved.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like you guys are underappreciated. So we're gonna keep doing what we can to help advocate for farmers like Will and agriculture in general. We appreciate you taking the time with us today. It's been really fun. And now I wanna be a farmer. If you guys have any questions, be sure to leave them in the comments section for us. And if we don't know the answer, maybe Will can help us out with some. Thanks again for watching. I'm Callie, and this is Will, and we're with Ag Aviation Adventures.